After acquiring the horses needed for their army, Liu Bei started to consider producing weapons. He planned to produce 5 different types of weapons of different power: axes, swords, pikes, spears, and clubs, to boost up the army's strength. Liu Bei had limited materials available, iron and wood, to make the weapons, and a certain number of woodsmiths and carpenters who could create them for him. Each weapon consumed different amounts of these resources during production. With this in mind, Liu Bei wanted to determine how many weapons he could produce to maximize the total power of the army, based on the amount of resources at his disposal. In front of this complicated problem, he took out his magical tablet.
Our heroes have gathered the army. They've improved the morale. Now it's time to make sure that the army has weapons to fight with. So they're going to build 5 different kinds of weapons. So they're shown here. And each of them has a different strength. So here's the strength of the various different weapons. So some are stronger than others. And they've got a limited amount of resources to use. So they've got 5,000 units of iron, 7,500 units of wood, 4,000 hours of blacksmith time, and 3,000 hours of carpentry time. And so there's going to be a resource consumption for building each weapon. So for example, for the sword, we're going to need 2 units of iron, no wood, 2 units of blacksmith time, and no units of the carpenter's time. For the club, we're going to need 0.1 units of iron, 2.5 units of wood, 0.1 units of the blacksmith's time, and 2.5 units of the carpenter's time. So we basically have this array of each of the resources and how much each of the weapons needs to build it. And we've got a capacity constraint. So basically, we've got to build a number of weapons that still fit within the budget of each of our 4 different resources. And of course, what we're trying to do is optimize the strength of all the weapons that we build together. So if we sum up for each weapon how much its strength is, then we're going to have the strongest possible army to use those weapons. So we should notice that this problem looks very similar to some earlier problems we've seen. So we have our products, which are the weapons, and each of them consumes some amount of resources. Here we have multiple different resources that they're going to consume part of. And the constraints and the objective are also similar. We basically have one kind of constraint, which is that we can't use more of a resource than we have. And our objective is to maximize something. In this case, we can call it profit, but here we're maximizing strength. If we look back at some of the earlier problems we've looked at, they fit right into this framework of problems. So we have gathering an army. So what did we have? We had one resource, which was the budget, how much we could spend to hire the soldiers, and we had one product, which was the soldiers. And in the peach garden banquet problem, we had one resource, which was the table space, the amount which we could fit in the table, and the products that we were designing or choosing about were the dishes. So basically all of these problems, gathering an army, the peach garden banquet, and choosing the weapon production, are all examples of the same model. And we can build one generic model to do all of these. So let's have a look at that model. So basically we have this enumerator type talking about the products that we want to build, or we want to choose how much of we're going to do. And we have a profit that we make for each of those products. So in this case, we're maximizing strength. Our profit is basically that strength. And we have a number of resources that we're going to have a capacity for. So in this case, we have 4 initial resources, which is iron, wood, blacksmith time, and carpentry time. So then we have this array, basically, for each product and each resource, how much does it consume to build one unit of that product? And that's the array that we saw earlier. So notice here we're also using floats rather than integers. So we're using floating point numbers here so that we can talk about consumptions like 0.5 and 2.5 that we saw in the example array earlier. So here is a 2-dimensional array declaration. So for each product and for each resource, we're going to give you that consumption amount. So that's the first time we've seen a 2-dimensional array. Now, we have the rest of the model. So what are we deciding? We're deciding for each product, how much do we produce? So that's basically the decisions that we're going to make in all of these examples. And we have to produce a non-negative amount of each product. So there's our example here, of a constraint exactly like we saw in the peach garden banquet problem. And then the one real constraint is that we can't use more than the available resources. So basically we're going to say for every resource, we're going to have this capacity constraint problem, which says I'm going to sum up for each product the consumption of that product on that resource times the amount that we produce. That's going to give me the total amount of that resource which we use for building this particular product. I'll sum those all up over all products, and that better be the less than the capacity for this particular resource. And we'll do that for all resources. So basically we're adding one constraint for each resource, saying we don't use more than that resource. And then finally we're trying to maximize our profit. So basically we're summing up over all products the profit that we get out of building one of that product times the number that we produced. And then we're going to have some output statement saying how much do we produce of each product, because that's what we need to know, that's the decisions. So here we have an example of a two-dimensional array lookup, which is not very different from it is in most languages, right? We're looking for each product and each resource, the consumption. So as we've seen in the previous slide, arrays can be multi-dimensional and they can be declared by this array, then index at 1, index at 2, index at 3, 4, 5, 6, etc., of type, whatever kind of array that you're building. And the index set of the array, these need to be an integer range or an enumerated type, and it could also be a fixed set expression whose value is a range. So basically they need to be ranges or enumerated types when we're declaring the size of an array. And the elements of the array can basically be anything except another array. So our array product resource of integers is how much we consume. Another useful thing we'll see, not in this model, but in other models, is the length function, which gives you the length of a one-dimensional array, since we'll be building one-dimensional arrays quite frequently in music models. So let's talk about how we initialize arrays. So one-dimensional arrays are initialized using a list. So we could initialize the profit for two different items like this. And we've seen this already in the Peach Garden Banquet, where we initialized our one-dimensional arrays for satisfaction and size using lists. Two-dimensional arrays are initialized using a special 2D syntax. So it starts with this, which tells us it's the start of a 2D array, so square brackets and vertical bar. Then a vertical bar for separating the different rows, which is the first dimension. And it ends with this thing, a vertical bar, close brace. And you can see here, here's our consumption array. We have one row per product and one column per resource. That's our two-dimensional row, which is product times resource. So you can initialize any array of dimension less than or equal to 6 also using this array nd family of built-in functions, which will turn a 1D array into an nd array. So here's another way of building the consumption array. So we're building an array 2D. Its first dimension is size 5, its second dimension is size 4. And here's the 20 elements of the array in this row column order. So here's the things for the first product, the second product, third product, fourth product, fifth product, and it's basically being broken up into a one-dimensional array. So if you know anything about how arrays are stored in memory in languages like C, this should be familiar with you. It's just a way of revisiting that memory, these 20 numbers in a row, in a two-dimensional format. So once we have arrays, we can do many, many things with them. And one of the things we can do in MiniSync is use array comprehensions. So array comprehensions are like array comprehensions in other languages like Haskell or ML, and they allow us to build arrays of various different forms. So an array comprehension looks like this. It can be an expression and then a number of generators, and we'll talk briefly about what generators look like. And basically each of these generators is going to generate different sets of values, and we're going to generate a copy of this expression for each of these sets of values. We can also have an array expression with the generators here and a where clause and a test. And then we're going to generate all the possible values these generators can value, and those which pass the test will cause the creation of one of these expressions in this array. So it's probably easiest to look at an example. So here is a generated expression which says I and j are going to take the values from 1 to 4. Now, I will vary most slowly. So the first value you'll get is I is 1, and then you'll try j is 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you'll try I is 2, and j is 1, 2, 3, 4. But here we're only going to allow the possibilities where I is less than j to pass this where test to actually generate a copy of this expression here. So of the 16 possible values, combinations of I and j in 1 to 4, Basically, only 6 of those will pass the test. So when I takes the value 1, we'll try setting J to take the value 1, it'll fail the test. Then we'll try setting J to the value 2, that will pass the test, and we'll generate our first expression here, 1 plus 2. Then we'll set J to 3, we'll generate 1 plus 3, then J to 4, we'll generate 1 plus 4. Now we've run out of J values, then we'll go back to I and generate its next value 2. We'll try setting J to 1 and 2, neither of those will pass the test, and then we'll generate the next expression 2 plus 3, then J will go to 4, we'll get generate 2 plus 4. Then we'll run out of J values, we'll try generating a new value of I of 3, we'll try J values 1, 2, 3, all of those will fail the test, and when we try 4, we'll pass the test. And then we've run out of J values, so we'll try generating I as 4, and then we try all of the J values and none of them pass the test. So basically these are the only 6 values which we generate. These 6 expressions are generated, and of course they can be evaluated to this array here. So arrays can also be built using this ND family. So we've already seen this where we can take this one-dimensional array and convert it into a multi-dimensional array, in this case here a two-dimensional array. We can go the other way using a comprehension. So if I want to flatten a two-dimensional array or an n-dimensional array into a one-dimensional array, then I can build a comprehension. So here's a way of taking this, the two-dimensional version of consumption, and converting it back into this list here, a one-dimensional array. So it's going to be an array of 1 to 20 of integers, our list. And what are we going to do? We're going to look at every consumption value that occurs, where I ranges from 1 to 5, that's the number of products, and j is 1 to 4. So basically this array comprehension, here's the one generated and the second generated, no where test here. So we're going to generate all 20 combinations of the consumption array. Basically we're going to build this one dimensional array we see here out of the two dimensional array we saw earlier for consumption. So iteration is basically done through these built-in functions that operate over a list or a set. And so we've already seen some of them, some that operate on a list of numbers, a sum, and one which operates on a list of constraints is for all, but there are other ones, product, min, and max, these are the most popular ones that we're going to use, which operate over a list of numbers, and exists is another generator which operates over lists of constraints. And basically, really, Minisync provides special syntax for calls to these functions. So when we write down this for all expression here, so this says I and j are going to vary from 1 to 10, where I is less than j, and we've got this, we're generating this constraint, a of I is not equal to a of j, then actually we're really, this is just syntactic sugar for writing down this list comprehension or array comprehension followed by an application of for all. So we're building up this a of I not equal to a of j as an expression, and we're doing that for all ij pairs in 1 to 10 where I is less than j. So basically when we write down this for all expression, we're just writing actually down this list or array generation expression followed by a call to for all. So this is really just special syntax for this generator function. So now we can come back to our weapon production problem. So here is our data. We have our 5 different products, the different profits for each product. We have 4 different resources and the capacity of each resource. And then we have our consumption array, which is basically for each product and each different resource, how much we need. So here you see a two-dimensional array constant using the syntax that we explained last time. 1 per row and 1 column per resource. When we run this weapon production data, we can get out an answer, seeing that how much of each weapon we need to build and how much profit we're going to make. And so the heroes are ready to arm the army. But remember, we said that this general model could work for other problems that we've looked at. We can look back at the problems we looked at before. So here was gathering an army. Here were our 4 products here, which were the different villages. Here was the profit, so that was the strength of each of the villages that we were going to recruit. We had 1 resource, which was just the amount of money we could spend at a capacity of 10,000 in the original gathering an army problem. And then our consumption array. So this note is a two-dimensional array, but one of the dimensions is only of size 1 because we've only got 1 resource. So basically it looks a bit strange, but basically it's a two-dimensional array with 1 row per product and just 1 column. So we can do the same with the peach garden banquet problem. So here's the heroes table version. We had our 3 different products, which were the different dishes we can serve, the profit or the satisfaction in this case for each of those, There's only one resource here, which is the size of the table at a capacity of 18, and again, a two-dimensional array of consumptions. And notice here, we're also using floating point numbers, whereas before we used integers. So we could use the default solver G code, and it would actually work correctly because it does handle floating point numbers correctly. But we would rather solve this problem using a mixed integer programming solver like G12 MIP, because the solving is almost instantaneous, because in fact, this production planning problem is a mixed integer programming problem. So a mixed integer programming solver is ideal. So we can control these solvers. If we go into the preferences part of our IDE, we can see which solver we're using, by the way. So we have to be careful when we start using floating point numbers that we may not always get accurate results. And this is true of basically any use of floating point solvers. They don't always give you accurate answers. So what we've seen here is how to build a model which applies to differently sized data. And that's important because the real world is full of solving the same problem again and again, and the data may change every time. And basically the usual approach to this is we'll define an enumerator type to name our set of objects that we want to reason about, and that may be a different type. It's a set up differently in a different data file. We use arrays to capture information about those objects, and then we use comprehensions to build the constraints and expressions that reason about this differently sized data.